Hi everyone, welcome to our fourth lecture. Today we will start with web development technologies and we'll start with HTML and CSS. HTML was the original hypertext markup language, and in the current version it describes the structure of a web page. Initially, it also described the style of a web page with attributes for background color, and so on. But now that is basically was factored out into CSS cascading style sheets. The original attributes are still there. You can actually set background color, and so on using attributes in the text, in HTML text. However, in the current version of HTML, it's recommended that you basically have the structure of the web page in the HTML page and the style in a separate part. By the way, at any moment, if you have any questions, you can unmute yourself and basically ask questions or type them in the chat. From time to time, I will basically check the chat for questions. And there was a question if there is a quiz today. No, there is no quiz today. There will be a quiz next week, and I tell you now about it. Tuesday, I will basically give a simple quiz to write a simple HTML using and CSS. Anyway, so let's return back. So HTML contains elements, and these elements describe how to render the content of a page. Like, for instance, H1 is a header, P is a paragraph, and so on. And these elements are enclosed within tags. And tags are basically start and end tags. They surround and describe the content. A start tag is basically a text within angle brackets, like for instance, body. And an end tag is text with leading forward slash in angle brackets, meaning the end tag for a tag that started before. And these tags in HTML must be properly nested. Now, this is mandatory. However, browsers will still show web pages that are not syntactically correct. They may miss some end tags, or they have end tags that never started, and so on. They do the best, basically, to render those web pages. In fact, there was at one point where almost 80 to 90% of all web pages on the web were syntactically erroneous. But we are getting better. There was XHTML as a standard that basically made it mandatory to enclose correctly tags. But now in the current HTML5, it's still a mandatory condition, but as I said, is accepted as not being quite mandatory. Now, so there are tags which basically surround an element, and there are attributes of those elements, and they are contained within tags to refine the operation of the tag. So a tag with attributes would look like this one, basically a tag name after angle bracket, and then attribute equal value, comma, attribute equal value, and so on. So basically attribute equal value pairs separated with commas. The value, if it's multiple values, they are separated by spaces. So we'll see today that there are attributes like background, where you actually enumerate multiple values. In fact, you are enumerating the background color, the color of the text, and so on. So, or the image, and so on. So basically, you enumerate multiple values, but really it's a tuple, because you will get those values, in fact, and they populate a certain set of attributes. So let's look at a simple HTML page. And you can basically look at any HTML page at any moment to see the correctness of the code and to see the structure of the code. And you can do that by basically just selecting the page that you want to see and view the source page for that specific page. So for instance, this is the HTML for this course, the Fundamentals of Software Development. I basically write this for our class. I add notes and so on. And you can already see that it has two parts. It has the header part and then it has the body. The header are basically properties that are not shown in the page, but they are actually important. So loading specific CSS files, specifying the title of the page, loading JavaScript, and so on. So in this case, I'm actually using a certain CSS and JavaScript framework called Bootstrap. Then in the body part is basically the structure of the page. You may have a navigation bar, you may have divisions. These divisions are basically elements that are not shown in the page. They are just used to divide the web page into different parts, so you can individually basically address that those parts. You can define classes for these divisions, and you basically can change their style. Now, there are other things in an HTML page. You will see there are headers, there are italic code, properties of text. There are hyperlinks, like for instance, this anchor A that specifies a certain hyperlink. There are tables, I will show, there are paragraphs, there is strong text, and so on. In time, you will learn all of this, but basically today we'll learn the basic ones. Like, for instance, we'll learn how to write a table, rows within that table, columns, and headers within that table, and so on. So let's return back to our simple HTML page. So usually, an HTML page starts with basically a declaration of the type of that HTML page. So in this case, I'm defining that this is a doc type HTML. And then I enumerate several tags. Basically, there is the header part, which is not shown in the page, but which defines properties or loads other files. And then there is the body part, which will basically load, will show in the web page. And in that body part, there are basically headers, paragraphs, and so on. Now, one thing that you should know about HTML is that it's not a programming language. It is a markup language. So you will not see variables defined or algorithms defined in HTML. HTML is defined for the sole purpose of presenting a structured web page. So it's a markup language. That ML in the HTML stands for a markup language, which basically equivalent markup languages are LaTeX, that allows you to write a paper, a document, and basically format it for a conference. So they are not programming languages, nor not classical programming languages like Java, C, Python. They are markup languages that allow us to actually format code. So basic tags in HTML are HTML. It surrounds the entire document. There should be one. A head and the end tag for head. It surrounds the header material like title, CSS info, either that is defined here or loaded, loading scripts, and so on. Body tag, which contains the main content of the page. Paragraph tag, which holds a single paragraph, like a line or a paragraph in a text that the browser will typeset separately as a separate paragraph. And then there are various headings. So header one is the biggest and strongest, largest header. Then there is header two with smaller font, and header three, header four, and so on. So basically, there are standard ways to structure and show a document. If you think about a web page that presents, like for instance, a manual, you would have a header one for the title, header two for the various sections, header three for the subsections, and so on. Now, another basic tag are links. So these are hyperlinks that allow us to navigate from one page to another. And when we click basically a link, sorry for the typo, it will take us to the new page. So the standard format for a hyperlink is the tag A, And then the attribute href lowercase or uppercase equal with the URL target. And the URL target can be within double quotes, within single quotes, or just in text. Basically, it is not required that you put them within quotes whatsoever. Then a text after the start tag and an end tag for that anchor. A stands for anchor. Only the text in the inside this link will show up on the page. And basically, when you go with the mouse over it, you can click on it and it will take you to another web page or to the current web page, but a different ID in the current web page. We'll learn about that a little bit later. Now, the target attribute indicates which window or tab should be used for the linked page. So an attribute that you can put in the anchor after the href or even before is target equal underscore self means open the current web page, basically open the web page in the current tab. So it will replace the current tab with the new web page that you opened. This is the default behavior. Target equal underscore blank means that the new page, that the new link will open in a newly created tab. So these are basically two targets which can be basically opened, the open in the self in the current tab or in another tab, a new tab that is created. Image. Image will display an image and it has to be in a file with extension GIF, JPG, PNG, and so on. It actually depends on the browser, what kind of image formats does it accept. But most browsers accept all of the, these are the compressed image formats, and there are the uncompressed ones like bitmap, which is basically the color of every single pixel in the image. The format looks kind of like the anchor format. IMG is the tag. The source is basically equal with the URL for that image. And we'll talk about this URL. It can be relative to the current web page, or it can be absolute. And some of you may have taken CSC 320, where you basically learned about absolute paths and relative paths on a computer system, which basically an absolute path is a path that basically it's from the root of the computer system. In the case of the web, it will be from the a DNS server or directly an IP for a server, and then the path to the file that contains that image. A relative path is a path relative to the current web page. So it starts from the URL of the current web page, and in that URL can basically go into an image in the current folder, or can go up with double dot basically slash, and that basically goes up in the hierarchy, or you can go down in the hierarchy. Then you can specify the width and the height. If you don't specify them, then you will get the size of that image put in the HTML page. And an alternate text to display. Basically, when you go with the mouse over that image, it will display that specific text. And these are the various attributes that can appear for images. So let's return back to href. So href was basically used for anchors, for links within the current page. And this href attribute can be any URI or local file. If you are opening basically a file on the local system, an HTML on the local system, and you want to open some image that is also on the local system, you can have the link to that file. The URI should include the protocol. So HTTP colon, basically the protocol that you are using, or HTTPS, the server, and the path. And the local file can be specified with an absolute path or a relative path again. So basically, you can specify a local file on the server if you want to, with an absolute path or relative to the current path of the HTML that you currently have open. The content can be text or an image. So href can basically have that text that it will appear as the link. But sometimes you can also put an image as the link. Now that image will be rendered, but if you click on it, it will take you to that specific target. Okay. There is a title attribute, which is used to provide the descriptive text, which again, what happens is that when you go with the cursor over the link, you will basically get that specific text that is the title attribute for that link. So maybe you want this is a file to, let's say, grades or something. So even if the path itself contains some random characters, you can still visualize what is that path taking you to. Now, links can be bookmarks created with the ID attribute on a tag. And in that case, it will scroll to the section marked with that named ID. So first, we start with a simple example in the same page. So you have some header 2, which has an ID equal more styles. And below, we have a link, anchor, hreference, hyperlink reference, hash sign, more styles. So now, if you click on that specific link, it will take you, it will move the page with basically to more styles as being the top of the current viewable area in the browser. So these are basically IDs that are used as specific points in a web page. And you can navigate to that specific point. So for instance, this is the way that you can implement a menu at the beginning or a table of contents that will let you go skip directly to a specific section that you are interested in. So you are using an inner link to one ID that is defined somewhere else in the current page. From another page, you can also get to the same position in the current page. So you basically use the same URL that you had for that web page that you basically wanted to open, some webpage.html, and then hash sign more styles will take you to the ID more styles. So now by clicking on this link with the text info on styles, it will take you not only to the some webpage.html, but within that position. So the top of the page, unless you are actually now with that style, you are on the bottom already of the current viewable area, you will basically get to that specific area so you can read it. So this is basically all about links. Any questions? At any time, just feel free to stop and ask me. Which number? Ah, the width and height. Yes, it's in pixels, but you can specify centimeters, inches, whatever you want. Actually, later I will show you that you can specify the width of a border or the width of a margin within a paragraph. And you, by default, you get it in pixels, but you can change it. You can say 10 centimeters or 1 centimeter. Millimeters and so on. So it has the set of standard measurements available. So that's all about this question about what's the width is equal with a number and the height is equal with a number. And what do these numbers represent? By default, they are pixels, but you can also set them to a specific measurement unit. And that's a measurement unit within your desktop size. Okay, next topic, lists. So there are unordered lists and ordered lists, and the list elements within one list is basically, they are enclosed within tags li. Okay, so let me show you an example. So here we have an HTML web page that contains an unordered list. And you see I'm using UL for the unordered list. And then I specify for every one of the items in that unordered list, list item, that's why LI stands for, the items enumerated one after another. Now, you see that you put one unordered list at the beginning tag and close the end tag for unordered list. You don't enclose each one of the items separately. That will create, in fact, three different unordered lists. They will look something like this, but with more space between the items. Okay, but this is a real list. It basically contains three items in an unordered list. And below, we have three items within an ordered list. And the ordered list, by default, it has counters which start with numbers, okay? So now, you can add styles to these lists. So for instance, the first question that you may have is, can I change the style of, instead of a circle, something else for the items in a list? And the answer is that yes, you can use the attribute list under dash style dash type. So when you define your unordered list here, you can define an attribute list dash style dash type equal, and you can choose circle, square, disk, which is basically a not filled square, none, no bullet whatsoever, and so on. So here it's an example. There are two different HTML documents. In one of them, I'm creating an unordered list with the style being a disk. And in the other one, I'm creating an unordered list with the style being a square. Okay. There are many formatting tasks for text. So by default, basically we have the following: bold. B stands for bold. Strong is also bold, is called actually important text, but if you look at any HTML document, I will show you an example next, it's also about the same bold factor. Similarly for italic and emphasized, italic I is italic text, emphasize again, it's emphasized text similar to italic. Marked is kind of like a marker, so the text within the mark portion will be marked with a color, by default yellow, like we have in normal, like standard markers, majority of markers. Small is smaller text, a little bit smaller text. DEL stands for stroked text, basically text that is stroked with a line through the middle. Ins is inserted text. I will show you what this means in the next page. Subscript and superscript. And here we have all of these examples. So normal text, if you have just some text within a paragraph, it will look like normal, not italic, not bold, not underlined, basically just normal text. Then bold, basically it's bolded text. And I should have probably put strong next to it, so you can see that bold and strong are basically, they basically look the same. You can see that italic and emphasized look basically the same. They are both italic, in fact. Marked is this cool feature that you can basically mark certain areas like you would do it with a marker. Small is basically a little bit smaller text. DEL stands for stroked text. Text that is straight through. Inserted is basically text that is underlined. Superscript is superscript text, and subscript is subscript text. Comments. Now, Java HTML is not like programming languages where you have two types of comments. You have line comment and paragraph comment. Really, what you have in HTML is paragraph comment. You can enclose anything within less than arrow, exclamation sign, dash, dash, and dash, dash, greater than, anything, like multiple lines or one line, and it will be ignored by the browser. Basically, it's not rendered in the web page. It doesn't play any role of style or anything like that. So in many cases, it's used for a portion of the page that is not shown. So let me show you an example. in my source, because I'm developing many of these lecture notes, there are parts which are hidden. It doesn't seem to be any in the main page, but I'm doing it quite often that I want to hide something. Like, basically, it's not totally hidden. If you look at the source, it's there, but I want to hide something, like a lecture note until the lecture, or I want to hide an old lecture note. I can comment it out and it will not be shown in the web page. That's what this is. It's basically a comment in HTML. Now let's talk a little bit about styles. So styles can be included in tags, and there is a special attribute style, which allows you to basically specify the styles that you want within one string. And then you can basically put attribute, colon, value, pairs, separated with semicolons. So you have multiple attributes, which are basically proper style property names, like blackboard, background color, color, font family, and so on. And this is all within one style. So the style for a specific tag is basically this list of attributes. We'll talk more about styles later, but basically there is an order of priority. So if you have multiple styles defined, at there is, first of all, inner styles, styles within a tag itself, are the highest ranked styles. They override if there is a CSS written at the level of the file or imported from a different file. Now, there is another idea of properties, and those of priority, and that priority is the fact that later styles are the ones that have higher priority. So if you are importing, let's say, a style, and then later you define it within, after you import it within the same page, the one within the same page, the last style before rendering will be the one that will be used for rendering. Now, sorry, I saw a typo. There are multiple properties, style properties, common style attributes, and those are background color for the background color of a paragraph of a text, color for the color of the text itself, font family to specify the family of fonts, font size to specify the size in pixels, text align to specify the alignment. So for instance, here is an example. I have a paragraph where the style of this paragraph is the background color is red and the color is black of the text. And this will be the text that will be basically rendered. So paragraph text will be enclosed within a small rectangle for one paragraph that has the background color red, and the text color black. Later, we'll actually see that using cascading style sheets is actually easier and less error prone, because you can standardize an entire website to look in the same way. You import the same common CSS file, and there are three different ways, again, to specify what's the style. You can specify the style for a specific tag, like every paragraph uses this style. Or you can specify the style for an ID, for basically all of those tags that share the same ID. Usually there is only one. And you can specify the style for a class. And that basically means that for all of the tags that belong to that class, the style is basically one class. And we'll see it a little bit later today. Tables. So HTML supports creating tables, and it basically has the tag for table, start and end table. It encloses the entire table. TR is for rows. They basically specify where one row begins and where it ends. TH or TD are basically cells. So TH is a tag that is used for column headers, table headers. So for instance, the first, usually the first row in a table, or the last row in a table if you have the headers on the bottom, are defined with TH. And TD stands for one single cell somewhere in the table, internally in the table. Caption defines the caption for the entire table. And you can put the caption on top. So basically you can define it before any TH, or you can actually set the caption on the bottom. And here we have an example. Basically, I define a table, and you can see other styles. Like for instance, I can define that this table will take the size of the currently viewable area in the browser. So basically I know that the size of this, the browser, ends somewhere here. When I took the screenshot for this, it basically, it was one page that the entire page 100% was the table on in WIF. Then I have the further header, basically a row in which I have first name as the table header of the first column, last name as the table header of the second column, and age as the header of the third column. So you can basically see the first row is first name, last name, age. And then the end of the current row, and it starts another row. So in the next row, we have Jill Smith, 50. In the next row, we have Eve Jackson, 94. And then we have John Doe, 80 as rows. And this is a simple table. If you do your homework, you will basically use a simple table like this to specify a large schedule. No? Now, HTMLs are used to show data, but also to collect data, respond to queries from the user. Like for instance, you enter your name and you press a submit button. This basically is done through what is called a form tag. So a form tag encases the entire form with all of the input values. Forms contain a number of input elements as well as text fields. There is at least one input to indicate when to submit a form to the back end, basically the server. And forms have multiple attributes. Action indicates the script on the web server that is run when the submit action is selected. So for instance, you click a submit button or an OK button. Now, action, it will be the link that will be loaded next. And in some cases, it's actually a call to a server which will run some script that generates the document that will be returned back to the browser. And then there is the attribute method. So how is the data sent basically to the other machine? And there are many different ways to send data over HTTP. Last time we enumerated all of the HTTP various ways. So there was info, get, put, post, and so on. The default HTTP method used is get. And the idea of get is that the attributes with attribute value pairs will follow if you click any link or basically the form submit. It will follow you the entire link, and that's visible on the server after you click. So for instance, a question mark with an attribute, the input attribute and the value will be visible in the browser link, okay? Input tags within a form are all of those input tags that are basically inputs from the user. Like for instance, you are reading a text. That will be within an input tag. And there are various fields of various types of inputs. There are radio buttons, we'll see that today. There are text fields, there are checkboxes, and so on. So let's start with a simple form. So basically we have here a form. HTML forms is the header, the form action is action underscore page dot php. It's a server script on the it's a script on the server, and I will not go into more detail. Basically, it's the file that will be executed in the server when the button submit is clicked, and basically generates some HTML output that is returned to the user. And there are multiple inputs in our form. So the first input is text. Basically, we are asking for the first name. The default value is Mickey, and that's the first input. BR stands for break. So it's one. It's one of the only tags that does not have an end tag. So basically, you have the BR and that's it. You don't need to close it. It's understood that BR stands for just a line break. We have multiple other inputs. So we have last name, default value mouse, age, default value 0, gender, male, female, or unspecified are basically radio buttons. So what exactly is a radio button? In the past, I don't know too much about newer cars, but for instance, my car has channel buttons, like 6 channel buttons. If I press one, it automatically disconnects any of the other ones that was basically pressed before. So that's what a radio group is, a radio group. And in this case, this is the radio group with the name gender, contains 3 options. And at any moment I click any one of the 3 options, it unselects the other 2 if they were selected before. So that's a radio group with radio buttons. And as I said above, we have 3 text fields. Now, the next text, miscellaneous text, are pre-formatted text. The browser basically will render the content in its as it's written in the HTML file. So for instance, if you have code that may actually contain greater than, less than, you would put it within pre and this pre start and end tags. So okay, you can basically directly put text that will be rendered in the web page at a specific location wherever you put this pre. Break adds a line break, and there is no end of line break. And HR stands for horizontal rule or horizontal line. And again, there is no end of HR. Okay. And the reason for that, I can actually show it to you, is that when we basically finish all of the possible columns that map other columns that were defined before as headers, this end of line doesn't matter, because basically it does in the fact that it will actually tell you what is that page and why did you get an error. But in essence, it doesn't matter. It will be added by default. Okay, so any questions about HTML? And then we'll get into cascading style sheets, which are much, much harder. The slides are on the course website. And that's all questions that I can see. These are probably questions about the homework, that if you submit one HTML file, you have to embed the CSS file in it. Okay. It's in some ways cleaner for small pages if you put the CSS in the tag itself, but in effect, it will be not as clean when you start developing large applications with dozens of developers. And the rest of the questions are about the homework again. Okay, good. So CSS stands for Cascading Style Sheets. And again, it greatly simplifies styling within HTML documents. It's easy to keep consistent styling because the same CSS is loaded in multiple pages and the same classes are going to be used. And instructions are written as what are called rule sets. So here is an example of a rule set. There is a selector, and this selector can be a tag, can be a class, or can be an ID. We'll see the different ways to actually define them because they are actually defined differently in the next slide. Then you have the properties or the attributes and their values. So in this case, we have the color is red and the font size is 14 pixels. So the selector indicates the tag or any other element that will be formatted. Property value pairs give the attribute to define and the value of that attribute. So here we have property value pairs, color red, font size 14, value 4 pixels. So property value pairs give the attribute to define and the value of the attribute, and multiple property value pairs are separated by semicolon. Now, selectors in CSS can be any of the following three. It could be a tag name, like for instance, any paragraph will have a certain style. And this will apply to all of the tags of that type in the document. So if you define a style for P, any single paragraph will be basically following up that style. An ID, in which case basically you have some position in the page, a div or a header, and you have an ID for that, like for instance, foo. You can define the type of any foo element. Now, the last one is with a class. So a class will let you define the same property for multiple tags. And basically, it will not apply to any other element in the within the name class. Okay. So here is the way to define CSS styles. So if you have a tag, you can just specify the tag, and then you specify the attributes of that tag. So in this case, it's basically the alignment for any one of these will be central and the color is blue. Then we have an ID. So C4 is an ID, text align is left, and color is red. And basically applies the tag to any one of the elements with that ID, with ID C4 in our case. And finally, you have classes. So if you have the class center of CSS style sheets, then you can align, basically you can define the center and then define the alignment to one space after center. And then the color is the color, basically green or red, or you define an actual color with RGB color scheme. So you can also put multiple selectors within the same line. You can separate them with comma, and now you don't have to define them separately. So this basically says that H1, H2, header one, header two, and paragraph have the same style. Okay, good. So now CSS information can be put in three different places. In an external style sheet, and that can be used for the entire website. And actually even in other websites, you can load the CSS on a different website than the one that you have. Like for instance, you can load Bootstrap CSS from the actual source of the Bootstrap CSS. Each HTML file must make now the reference to the same sheet. You can have an internal sheet which can be used consistently within the current HTML page. Usually this is in the header. And you can have inline styles. You can basically define the style of the current tag that you are defining. So the first example, you have some external CSS file like my site style.css. It contains the background color for the entire body, which is light blue. And then you have the color for a header one, the color navy, and the margin left 20 pixels. I will actually show you what is this margin next, later today. So you have a separate file holding all the styles for the current document, and then you can basically use it using an element link. You specify that the type of this link rel is equal with style sheet. The type is the media type of what you are loading. And in the case of CSS is a text with a specific type that this is a CSS file, a cascading style sheet. And then the hyperlink reference to that specific file that you try to load. If you are in the same folder, you can use my_site.css, and that will load the CSS in from that other file. So you have a separate file, and then you have a link that links in the header that specific CSS. Okay. Then you can have internal style sheets. So using the enclosed tag style and end style, you can define actually CSS. So in this case, we basically have exactly the similar examples. We have the body color for the entire body of the page is linen, and the color and margin left for a header one tag will be maroon and 40 pixels. So this basically, all of this internal style CSS will be loaded in the head at the same time with the current page, okay? And the style is enclosed within style tags. Style can also be placed inside a tag, any kind of tag, any individual tag, as we can saw earlier. Like for instance, header one style is that the text color is red and the size is 14 pixels. Now, I said that there is a priority order. If you have the same style defined externally, defined internally, and defined within one tag, one example, like basically what we have here in this example, h1 style equal color red and text size 14. So with a mix of cascading style sheets that are coming to the current browser, internal style sheets in the same domain, external from a different domain, inline style sheets, which one do you apply if you have the same, element in all of the three places? The rules state that the inline styles defeat anything other than that. So for instance, you basically have the inline style as the style of the element, no matter what is loaded, if nothing was basically, no matter what is loaded in main memory or somewhere else. The external and internal style sheets, which basically contain the style sheet in the head section, using the order of links, style selections in the head, basically you can, the last style defined is the one that is going to be used. So if you had style defined for the entire web page, and then you have a style defined with the same name for a attribute name for a single for later in the same page, the later one will be the one that will be used. So the order of the styles, the later styles will be used unless an inner style is used on the element. Next, another order of priority, even if you have on the same page, more specific selectors are selected first. So for instance, if you have a style for paragraph and you say all the paragraphs are red, and then you have a style for an ID, all the paragraphs with ID 1 are blue, which color are you going to use for basically rendering? And the idea is that you are going to use the moment that you are trying to write the paragraph, you're going to use the style, the latest style, the style of the most specific. So the style of the ID. The style of the ID is more specific than the style of any paragraph. So in this case, the style of the ID will be selected. Any questions? So IDs are supposed to be unique, but again, HTML pages are not perfect, and there will be IDs that are the same, and you will get no error in, again, because the browser will render it no matter what. If you want to group multiple elements, Matthew is totally right. You're going to use classes, because then you can group all of the elements within the same class. Okay. Good. Okay, so let's go over the style attributes in CSS. Colors, backgrounds, borders, margins, padding, and we'll see the differences between these. One is for etched borders, like borders that are shown. Margins are for the space before the current element and after the current element. And the padding is the space within the current element. You can still specify basically how much space within the current element will be, the current object will be embedded in. And height and width. Now, colors can be specified in three different ways. You can specify a color with one of the 140 standard color names, which contain red, blue, and so on. So color that colon light blue will basically give the light blue color, like the New Orleans or Louisiana color. The red will give you a strong red color, and so on. Or you can specify the color with hash and then six basically hexadecimal digits. And each two stand for a color. So basically, and for one of, for the value of one of the three colors, RGB, red, green, and blue. So for instance, FF0000 stands for a strong red, because there is nothing else but red in that color, and all of the others are zero. 000066 stands for a lightish blue, because basically it's a small number, 66 in the last two digits. Two digits are basically standing for the value of one of the color values in the palette. So you RGB stands for red, green, blue, and then you are getting two hexadecimal digits that correspond to any one of the colors. So FF corresponds to R, 00 corresponds to green, and 00 corresponds to blue. Okay. So you have what are called two hex nibbles or two hex digits to give you the range between 0 and 255 for that specific color. Now, the third way is to actually specify that you are using RGB explicitly, and then you give the values of red, green, and blue within parentheses. So basically, this is what probably internally is done when you have colors defined. Okay. So here are a few examples. Header one color is green, and the every other paragraph color is red. Okay. Any questions? I will still update the web page. So I, as I said, the slides are written very late, and therefore the web page may not contain the latest version of the slides. Okay. Elements can also have different backgrounds, and the backgrounds can be of a certain color or with an image. So the attribute to specify the color for an element is background dash color. And the value is a description of the color in the same way that we describe colors for color attribute. So header ones will have the background color green, and div basically one the every division will have the background color 777700. So this is basically red with green, mid red with mid green. I assume that this is some kind of an orange, okay? Because in RGB, if the two first two have approximately the same value and the third one, blue, has no value, I would assume that this is something between green, red and green, and that's probably a kind of like an orange. And now we actually see our new tag, div. So div is actually a tag, an element, and is just used to divide the page into subsections. There are no other structural effects on rendering the page, this div. It's just basically a way to separate a certain part of the page. Okay. Background image is also a CSS attribute. The value is usually a URL of a graphic file. And here is an example. The body has the background image mountain.jpg. And the images can be positioned within one element. Basically, you can use the attribute background position. And you can specify the value of where this will be put in the current element. And you can specify the horizontal and vertical positioning, which stands for left, bottom, center, right, and center, and top. So here we have an example. Basically, the body starts in the upper right corner, and it contains a mountain from some location in this case. The background color starts with the string URL, open parentheses, and then the color within quotes. Okay. So in this case, basically, the background image for the entire page will be a mountain, and the background position, it will be top right, in the top right corner. Okay. Because of this top that you see here in the vertical positioning. Okay. Background image, if they are too small for the entire area that they have to cover, you can use a background repeat attribute. And you can repeat basically the images on the horizontal from left to right, repeat X. Or you can repeat the images one under another, which basically is repeat vertically down area, repeat Y, and non-repeat, which is the default. Images can also scroll within the page, and the attribute for that is background attachment scroll. We can also specify all attributes using background. So here is an example of multiple values for one attribute. So background in the bottom, body, the background of the body is a URL, and repeat X. Scroll top and right. And basically the meaning is that you now you can specify only in this order. This order is very important. You have the color first, the image, the repeat property attached, and position in that order. And this is very important. Borders. So by default, if you remember, we have the table right at the beginning. We didn't have any kind of border for this form. So what exactly are borders? Borders basically specify the style, width, and color of the element that it borders. So you define a CSS border, and then you attach it to a file or through the drive, this system, or you load it from somewhere else. And the attributes for border are border style, which is a single keyword that basically specifies the style of the border, and it includes dashed, dotted, which are basically dotted lines with smaller and bigger area, segments between the field segments, solid, double, groove, ridged, inset, outset, none, and hidden. And one value applies to all of the four sides. Basically, you will get it for top, bottom, left, and right. One value for border will apply only to top and bottom, and the second value would apply to left and right. Three values, one will apply to the top, one will apply left and right, and the third one will apply to the bottom. And four values in which every side of the current element will basically have a different value in four values. Border width is basically the value of that border and can be specified in pixels, or it can be specified in centimeters and so on. We can use one of the three keywords for the border width also: thin, medium, and thick. And the border color is basically equal with colors of borders. Now, during this pandemic, it's basically any kind of one of the borders that we have, basically. Okay. And border color is the colors that we had earlier. Sorry about that. Okay. So the shorthands for the borders, if you don't want to specify the style separately, are border left style, border right style, border top style, and border bottom style. And the same with border X width and border X color. You can basically specify the border X and border width and color. Then there is border. So the same way that we specify multiple attributes for certain properties, like the background position is right and top, we can specify the attributes for border, but you have to specify them in this width, in this order. The width first, then space, the style, which is required, then spaced, and then the color. So for instance, if I want a border around every header one text, I can specify that that border has 5 pixels, it's solid, and it has orange color. And here I have an example. So basically I have an HTML file which contains every H2 header 2 border is of 10 pixels and is dashed green, and every paragraph has of a solid border of 5 pixels, which is red. And then we have a header 2 which will basically be surrounded by the border for header 2, and the paragraph which will be surrounded by the border for the paragraph P, so the one that we see here. So borders are basically the size of the border, the line around our object. Margin. It specifies the spacing of the current element outside the border from other elements. So similar to border, you can specify separate attributes for left, top, bottom, and right. But you can also specify it with four values for everyone, three values, which is basically top, bottom, and then a separate one single value for the sides, left and right together. Two values, which you basically specify the margin for the top and bottom in one value, and for the left and right for the other value. And basically application pattern is similar to border. And here we have an example of margin. So I have the division div tag will have a border of 1 pixel solid black with margins of 25 pixels for top and bottom. So that's why I have larger space on top and bottom, and 50 pixels for left and right. So I have a little bit more space in left and right than in top and bottom, because we have two values and one of them is half than the other. And the background color for any div is going to be light blue. So in our case, the this div element will be light blue and the rest of the sentence. So now the div appears after header 2, and it will basically have a top and bottom margin of 25 pixels and left and right margins of 100 pixels or 50 pixels, sorry. Okay, padding. So margin basically meant, as I said, the spacing outside the border. Padding generates space within the border. So again, there are attributes for padding, padding left, padding top, padding bottom, and padding right to specify separate values for each. The attributes for padding are length, a value in pixels or centimeters and so on. The percentage of the padding is the width of the document, usually 100%. And inherit means that the padding is inherited from the parent element. And here we have an example of margin. So before, for the example of shorthand, we basically had, if we put we do have this div, basically is separated from left and right with 25 pixels and top and bottom 50 pixels. Similarly for padding, only that this time it will be outside, it will be inside the entire box. So we'll basically have 50 pixels here unused, 20 pixels. So the padding basically adds spaces up and down. And because it's aligned left, that's the basically point. We have a left and right padding of 25, but the sentence ends somewhere in the middle. So that padding appears here, but is not actually used. So we have border, we have margins, which are outside the border. Then there is padding, which are basically spaces inside the border. The height and the width. Somebody was asking earlier what's the measuring unit and basically other properties of the height and the width. Height and width are attributes for any kind of element, and we can basically specify the position of that element. The default value for height and width is auto, which lets the browser specify what's the best size. Values can be specified in points, pixels, centimeters, and so on. So basically, they are standard values, and you specify the unit after the value. And the percentage of the containing block. Okay, so here is an example. Basically, I'm specifying that div, my division div that you see here after the text, the division element has 200 pixels. So div has a height of 200 pixels, a width of 50, and a background color of powder blue. And you can basically see this is actually a screenshot from the browser that shows that only 50% of the browser is light blue. The other right-hand side 50% is just empty. So these four different properties, the content, the padding, the border, and the margin, define what is called the box model. So the box model are the four different properties that define the look of a certain object. So the content is the content of the object. The padding is the area around the content, but within the border of the current element. Padding is transparent by default. A border that surrounds an element and padding, it's the border, and the margin is the area outside that border up to the other elements in the HTML page. And here is the example. Basically, I have an object that, let's say I bought earlier, it's going to be a border like a TV. Then there is the margin that says how far away I put other things to the TV. Then is the padding, which basically says when I, let's say, build a new TV in the image, I want basically the border to be 10 pixels away on all sides, or 10 pixels on the top, 12 on the left and right, and 14 on the bottom. So here is an example of the box model. So I'm defining for div all the box model. The width is 300 pixels. The border is 15 pixels solid green, which is what you see here. The padding is 50 pixels on all sides. And the margin is 20 pixels. So the margin of this is 20 pixels. Okay. Links. So you may have noticed the fact that the link has multiple styles. First of all, it has the style of the link before it's clicked. Then when you go with the mouse over it, it has a hover style. Basically, when you go with the cursor over it, the color and the style of that link. Visited is basically the link visited style. After that link, we open that page and we return back to the current page. And active is the link when the left mouse is depressed over it. And ordering is important. This must be in that order. So hover must be after link and visited, and active must follow hover. So here is an example. Like for instance, I define that any link in my document will have the style that there is no decoration by default. If for that link was not opened before, if it was already visited, then the color for that link becomes green. So this is a link after we visited that link. Hover is actually the style of the link. If I hover the button over it, so something like that's a link and I hover the button over it, it will basically give me the values, which you can see here is that it was calling a ASP page. The target was a new tab, and this is the link. Lists. We already saw a few examples earlier. So unordered lists can have a style of the bullet. Is it circle, square, disk, and so on. Order lists have the list style type, which could be open Roman, lower Roman, upper alpha, and lower alpha. Okay. And the position of an attribute is given by another attribute, element is given by another attribute called for a list called list style position. And the values could be inside, basically bullet or marker is pulled in with the text, so inside border. And outside, it means that the bullet or the marker is left outside the element's border, which is overhanging. And the shorthand for this attribute list style position is just list style. So here is a couple of examples, two examples. So first we have the list style for the IDA is basically the background has this color, and for the IDB, the background, it's inside link, and the background has this color. And we can see that I defined for the first unordered list class A, and for the second unordered list class B. And this is how they look actually. Tables can also be styled, and actually the same way that we style border, padding, text align, width, height, and others. And here is an example. We have all of the table column TD or header have a border of 1 pixel solid black. Then we have any table, the border collapse will be collapse, and the width is 100%. The header is defined here that is an alignment center. So now basically the rest is defining that table that we saw before, only that now in fact is going to use a border style, because that was listed right there at the beginning. So in summary, what we learned today are standard elements for HTML. They are used to describe the structure of a web page and the content. And it's static. There is no execution semantics. This is a markup language. And cascading style sheets, which help customize the look and feel of web pages. There are numerous ways to address elements and groups and lists and tables. And basically, how do you import a cascading style sheet? And next lecture, we'll talk about JavaScript. That's all for today. Let's see if there are any questions. Okay, so I see some questions. Would padding top decrease the padding on the decrease the padding of the bottom? No. So there are three styles. You can give one value, which is the padding of all the sides. You can give two values in which you are defining the padding top and bottom with the first value and left and right with the second value. You can give three values in which you have the top padding, the bottom padding independent, and the sides padding. And you have four values for the all the four values directions of padding. Not really. These are only the standard HTML. There are textbooks which cover more in detail HTML. In fact, I wanted to split that lecture into two, but then I decided that, in fact, we do have enough time. We just actually reached 6:05 standard time for the end of the class. So we will return back to more HTML and CSS in other classes. SCSS, I do not know what it is. I'm sorry about that, Ahmad. And I will find out for next class. So thank you very much, everyone. Have a nice weekend. Do the homework. You can do it with styles if you want. I saw a very good set of homeworks that were already submitted. So play with HTML and styles. This is why we have this homework, for you to start writing HTML manually. Okay, thank you very much. Have a nice day.
Have a good day, Professor.
Thank you. Bye.